That should be our prayer every day. That should be our request for him. Amen. To take us, to mold us, to make us like him. Put ourselves in his hand. We can never go wrong. Amen. Hallelujah. Lift your hands in worship to him. Just a silent lifting of hands. Lord, we worship you because you are the potter. You mold us. You make us. We are what you have done for us, Lord, and we're so thankful and so blessed. Amen. Praise God. Well, it's good to be in his house this morning, isn't it? Amen. It's good to be in his house, worship him, be with family members. That's exciting, isn't it? A lot of us have earthly families we don't like to be around, but we like to be around God's family. Amen. Yeah, where we're brothers and sisters in spirit. And in truth, thank you so much for being here. We appreciate it so very, very much. If this is your first time at Word of Life, please stop by our welcome desk. Inside your bulletin, on the far right side, there's a little welcome note to everyone, of course, but for you who are here for the first time, we want you to fill that section out. Take it to the welcome desk outside there in the narthex, that big, large foyer area, and some of the folks there will give you a gift and give you a personal greeting. And we thank you so much. We're glad that all of you are here. Let's welcome everyone. Come on, a big welcome to Word of Life. Amen. In your bulletin, we have a lot of things. It's summer. Summer's here. We can tell by the weather, the showers and the hot sun. That's summer in the D.C. area. But here at Word of Life, we just stay busy all the time, growing and learning in the Lord. Amen. And you can see in your bulletin, there's a host of things going on. And you want to make sure that you're part of those things that you can relate to, that pertain to you, that will help you grow in the Lord. I do have one correction. I see where, now we do this because a lot of this is on computer. It just kind of carries over, you know, the gist of things, the regular things. And we haven't had no service this evening, but please correct that, okay? Not only in your mind, but in your spirit, be here this evening, 6 p.m. every Sunday, unless it's some special time a pastor gives us off, then just be here and worship with God's people this evening at 6 p.m. During the week, we have Wednesday night classes, some powerful classes. There's something for every age person here at Word of Life on Wednesday night. And we're so appreciative for your help and your support and your prayers and all of this here, okay? We have Pastor Kathy's going to come at this time, and she has a special presentation to make. So here she comes now. Amen.
If the honorees this morning will make your way to the platform, we have a presentation this morning. We have a Bible school here at Word of Life, and these three students are being honored by receiving their diploma, their certificate. And the first is Maggie Thomas. Maggie Thomas has satisfactorily completed the prescribed program of study for level one in ministerial studies through Global University Berean School of the Bible. Congratulations, Sister Maggie. If you can step right over there and hold on to that. And the next is Carmen Justiniano. Carmen, you have satisfactorily completed the prescribed program of study for level one of Global University Berean School of the Bible and Ministerial Studies. Please receive this honor. And I don't know where Sister Maureen Cross is, but she has also completed this certificate of study.
She's coming.
Oh, is she? She's coming. Maureen Cross. Maureen Cross, you have satisfactorily completed the prescribed program of study for level one in ministerial studies from Global University Berean School of the Bible. receive this honor. One more round of hands for these students.
Congratulations to all of the recipients. They work hard, and we have some great classes here. And when does the next round of classes start, Pastor Kathy?
We may begin in August.
In August. You want to get involved in these courses, and they're very helpful. It's not just for someone that's studying for the ministry, but it'll help you in your everyday growth and walk with the Lord. Amen? All right. At this time, we're going to ask the ushers to come, please. And we're going to receive God's tithes and our offerings. And Pastor Kathy's going to pray for us as we are faithful in our giving to Him. Amen? Here's Pastor again.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You this morning because we have hearts that are filled with gratitude. We thank You for Your mercy and Your grace, and we thank You for so great a salvation. Lord, this morning we are giving to You out of what You have blessed us with. Lord, return it for Your kingdom. Use it for Your honor. Use it for people to come to know You as Lord and Savior. And we give thanks. Bless both the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name we say, amen.
Thank you so much. Today we have five beautiful little babies we're going to dedicate to the Lord. If the parents and those that are here to represent their families, please come and take your place in front of the altar. Okay, come closer to the altar, if you will, so that we have quite a representation. Okay, we'll introduce the first one to you. It's Simeon Abekwe, born May the 16th, 2015. Please come to the platform and hold your baby up so everybody can see it. And the little girl's coming along. Very good, beautiful family. Simeon means he who hears and obeys. Ubektuwu means the will of God. God presented our baby to us before he was conceived, saying, "He will be a gentle spirit." Our dreams for Simeon is that he hears and obeys the will of God, as the Lord God has written in the book of life and eternity by love concerning Simeon. God bless you. Amen. Bring you down. The next one is Adrian Abigail Navia. Born March the 20th, 2016. Adriana means creative and outgoing or friendly. Abigail means gives joy or a father's joy. We pray that Adriana will love God with all her heart and never leave him, that she becomes a woman of God that he created her to be and marries a godly man of integrity, that she is filled with faith, courage, determination, and perseverance to transform her generation. Our dream is that she will preach the gospel and be a prayer warrior traveling around the world. Jeremiah 1:10, "See today that I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and to tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant." God bless you. And our next one is Daniel Larty Oforiadu. Born March the 27th, 2016. Daniel means God is my judge. Larty means the son of the ruler. Daniel is the first grandson born into a family of pastors and believers. We dream he will be a responsible person and family man. We pray he will help spread the gospel and provide leadership to the lost and be used for building of nations. God bless you. And the next one is Jesseline Ramirez. Her name means a strong battle woman. It's ready for battle. Our dream is that she will grow in stature and wisdom in God's grace. May God give her wisdom and many gifts to be used for his kingdom. We pray she will serve God above all and use her in worship, singing unto the Lord. God bless you. And the fifth one is Angel Vargas. I'm sorry, these don't have the date birth on it. Angel means messenger of God. Angel is a living miracle. She was not growing in the womb, so they induced labor and was born at only 4 pounds. We pray she will grow with God in her heart and be an example for others on how to live by faith. We pray her light will shine because of God's love, and she will be a servant of the Lord. God bless you. As by now you know that in our church we do not baptize babies in water because we believe that water baptism is an outward sign of an inward belief. Until the child becomes of age, they are innocent. And when they become of age, then we pray that they will accept Christ knowledgeably. Then we will baptize them in water as they follow the Lord Jesus Christ. So today the parents have come to dedicate their children to the Lord. However, it is really a dedication of the parents, dedicating themselves to God, that they will give the child every advantage of education and of church and the Bible and family devotions, that they will raise their children in the fear and the admonition of the Lord Jesus Christ. Always remember that like the child has someone to look to, you have a Heavenly Father that you can look to in time of need, in time of sickness, in time of trials, and know that God cares and God knows, and He loves you and your child best of all. Amen. So we're going to pray the prayer of dedication, ask the audience to stand. Stretch your hand towards the children at this time and the parents as we pray. Father, we thank you today for the joy that you have brought to these families in the birth of their child that you've added to bring new life and a continuance of the family here on earth. I pray, Lord, that you would lead and guide them by your Spirit. Give the parents wisdom from heaven. You said if we lack wisdom, we can ask of you and you will give us liberally. So grant to them the wisdom to be the parents that will influence their children to the things of God. Lord, we know that we live in an evil world today. I pray that you would keep them from all that is evil. Protect them from all harm of terrorism and other events that are taking place in our world today. We look to you, Lord Jesus, and we dedicate them to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. We dedicate to you little Simeon Ebekwe. We dedicate to you little Adrian Abigail Navia. We dedicate to you little Daniel Ofori Adu. We dedicate to you Jesseline Romero Ramirez. And we dedicate to you little Angel Vargas. Lord, let the angels of heaven surround them, I pray. Bless their going out and their coming ins. May their family be united by the power of the Holy Spirit, both at home and in church and in the workplace, for the honor and the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. This we ask in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now we have some gifts that we're going to give. First, we have a certificate, but there's more than a certificate in here. There is a letter that is addressed to your child. When the child becomes of age, we want you to read this letter because it simply states what happened today. You brought them before the church. We prayed. We dedicated them to God and prayed that they will follow the Lord for the rest of their life. Also, there's a dedication certificate in this. Then we have the baby's first New Testament that we give to them and pray that that will be a guide to the family. Then we always present 3 flowers. The one is a red carnation, symbolical of the courage of fatherhood. The white carnation, symbolical of the purity of motherhood. Then the little rosebud that symbolizes this little life that is unfolding day by day. Parents, if you take this rose and try to open it up, you're going to make a mess of it. But if you allow God to do it, it's going to be a beautiful rose. Amen. So it is true with your children as you raise them and give them every advantage of school, of education, God's word, the gospel, and pray with them, God's will and purpose will be accomplished in their life. Thank you. God bless you. And you may find your places.
Okay, while they're going back, let's just all stand at this time and move about and greet someone. Let them know it's good to see them in God's house. Amen. Thank you. Okay, let's find our place if we can, and we'll move on with the service. Thank you so much. It's a great time to be able to greet someone, and you haven't seen them in a week, and this is a good place to find them on the first day of the week in the Lord's house. All right. Let me ask you a question. How many have noticed we have a brand new sidewalk? Raise your hand. Okay, a few of you do. Now this, we designate this Sunday, the fourth Sunday of the month, Miracle Sunday. Pastor always asks a question, how many need a miracle? Raise your hand if you need a miracle. I think everyone in the 8 o'clock service, in the 8 o'clock service, raise their hand. We all need miracles in some area of our life. Well, the church needs a miracle, and we need a miracle, and the word says that when we give to God, he gives back to us, amen? Given shall be given, pressed down, running over, shaken again. That's a wonderful promise from God. And God keeps his promises and keeps his word. As we give, as we need, we have a miracle that we need, we have a need, we give out of that need, and God blesses. And so that sidewalk was $24,500, and I believe that all of us together, by giving a little, will take care of that need. Amen? And God will meet our needs. Amen? Do you believe that? Say amen. Amen. This is how we live. This is God's system. And we adopt that into our life, and it works. If you know that works, say a hearty amen. 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 All right. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to give to your work. And Lord, many people raised their hands this morning that need a miracle. Perhaps some didn't raise their hand, but they need a miracle anyway. Sometimes we're hesitant, Lord, to come before you and say, Lord, I need a miracle. But God, you're the miracle worker, and we believe this. And when we practice our life after your lifestyle and after your word, then we see how true it is and how precious the promises come true in our life. So thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to give, to pay for this sidewalk, Lord, a beautiful new sidewalk to walk on, to come into the house of God each day. God bless your people now as they give. In Jesus' name, amen. And here is Melissa. Let's sing.
Good morning.
Mueven el estanque en mi ser. Úneme a tu río, dame vida. No sé qué palabras decir que provoquen que me quieras más de lo que me amas. Ven, Señor, como dijiste, derrama tu gloria, derrama tu gloria. Ven, Señor, como dijiste, derrama tu gloria,
Thank you. For all you who don't speak Spanish, that song is talking about God's promise and just inviting him into your life. And just like he said that he would, and he'll fill your life with love and just bring victory to everything that you do. God bless.
Thank you, Melissa. Today we're going to talk to you about how to reach our potential in Christ, because there are many, many things that we haven't attained to yet, but all of us keep pressing forward to reach the goals in our Christian life that God has for you and me. We're going to read from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 6 and 7, then Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. Brother Dan.
Wherefore I put thee in remembrance that thou stir up the gift of God, which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end.
And Father, we thank you for the promises given to us in your word. Thank you, Lord, that you lead and guide us day by day. You've given us many things to help us to remember the great things of God and the reason why you placed us here on earth. I pray that you anoint with the power of your spirit our hearts and our minds today. Find us where we are. Help us to become the individuals that you've called us to be. Speak to us in a language by your spirit that we can all understand. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Amen, amen. On the back of your bulletin is a pretty detailed outline of what we're going to bring to you. You can take it and study it and tell it to others ever how you would like to do it. Paul begins writing to Timothy to stir up his mind to help him to remember. How many have ever forgotten something you should remember? Sure. Okay, and some of you forgot to raise your hand, because everybody has. A lot of times it's difficult to remember some things that we're supposed to remember, and it's difficult to forget things that otherwise we should forget. But we pray that God helps us. This is one reason we gather around the communion table, to remember that Jesus came down to earth and gave his life for your salvation and for mine. I like what Jeremiah says in Jeremiah 29:11. If you don't have this as a special verse that you have memorized, I pray that you will do it. It's really, really encouraging. God says, I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord. What kind of thoughts is he thinking? Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. In other words, that your dreams in life might be fulfilled as you follow the Lord Jesus Christ. As a church in the body of Christ, we are equippers. That's why we have Global University, that the ladies today received their diplomas for studies that they have done. That's why we have Sunday school classes. That's why we have Wednesday night Bible studies, that we might be equipped in the things of God, that we might be able to serve him the way that God wants us to serve him. We are also the body of Christ, members one of another. That body doesn't end here. It reaches around the world today of all those individuals that know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. If we are going to reach our potential, first we must do it as a person. Each individual is responsible before God to serve him and become everything that God wants you to be. And if you do that, then the church will also be equipped to do what God has called us to do. The Apostle Paul comes near the end of his life, a great, great apostle who led many people to the Lord Jesus Christ. But at the end, he says, I'm still learning, I'm still growing, I'm still pressing forward with all the might that God give me that I might reach my goals in him. Philippians 3:12 to 14.
not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus.
Notice it's like a runner that is nearing the end of the race, and you have to pull together all of your efforts to reach the goals that God has for you and me. So we have not approached the place that God wants us to, and the way we're going to do that is forget the past, forget the failures, forget the successes, and know that the past is a past and nothing can change it, but we can look forward to the future because God is leading and guiding by the power of the Holy Spirit. Give the Lord a big hand. Now, we're going to do this. The way we're going to do it is, first of all, beginning with God. That's where it all begins. We're not going to begin with the ape or the gorilla or the monkey. I know that sometimes we act like monkeys, but that's not our heritage. We're made by God, and God breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Some time ago, I had a poem that was entitled, What the Monkeys Were Discussing, and they're discussing evolution. Did we descend from them or not? And they give a good argument for it. And I found it on YouTube, and the best way today is to play it for you. And this is one that Brother Gerald could do, and he can add it to his repertoire of things that he can sing. And here is the monkeys in a coconut tree discussing things that are said to be. Let's look at it.
The monkey speaks his mind. Now, three monkeys sat in a coconut tree, discussing things as they are said to be. Said one to the other, now listen, you two, there's a certain rumor that can't be true, that man descended from our noble race. The very idea is a big disgrace. No monkey ever deserted his wife, starved her baby, and ruined her life. Yeah. The monkey speaks his mind. And you never known a mother monk to leave the babies with others to bump, or pass them on from one to another till they scarcely knew who was their mother. Yeah. The monkey speaks his mind. And another thing you will never see, a monkey build a fence around a coconut tree and let other coconuts go to waste, forbidding all other monkeys to come and taste. Why, if I put a fence around this tree, starvation would force you to steal from me. Yeah, the monkey speaks his mind. Here's another thing a monkey won't do, go out at night and get on a stew, or use a gun, a club, or knife to take another monkey's life. Yes, man descended the weightless bum, but brothers, from us he did not come. Yeah, the monkey speaks his mind.
That's evolution from the monkey's viewpoint. And he gives a good argument, doesn't he? Some time ago, I remember this, it said, once I was an amoeba beginning to begin. Then I was a tadpole with my tail tucked in. Then I was a monkey and swung up on a tree. Now I am a professor with a PhD. The Bible tells us that we were born for a reason and a purpose is why God has placed us on planet Earth today. Without knowing that reason, life will seem empty and meaningless, just as the writer of the book of Ecclesiastes describes over and over, looking at life from our point of view and not from God's point of view. Ecclesiastes 1, 8 and 9.
All things are full of labor. Man cannot utter it. The eye is not satisfied with seeing, nor the ear filled with hearing. The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun.
And once again, Paul says that he hasn't approached or come to the place where he's apprehended everything that God has for him. But he doesn't count himself to apprehend it. But forgetting the things which are behind, he's going to look forward to the things which are ahead because God has a great future for you. Amen. God has a great future for each one of us. Don't let the past predict your future because God is able to change that. And that's why we have God's amazing grace that reaches down to you and me, finds us where we are, and helps us to become the individual that God has for you and me. The second thing, we need to know our potential in worship. God chose to create us for his own enjoyment. Now, God was complete in himself and he didn't need us, but he created man in his own image that he might worship and praise him. We exist for God's benefit, for God's glory, for his purpose and his delight. Mark chapter 12 and verse 30.
And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment.
The first commandment that God gives is love God with all your heart, all your strength, all your mind. Too many times our minds are divided. One time we believe, the next time we don't. Just like Israel, who one day trusted God, but then they trusted idols, and it led to their degradation, their downfall, because they forgot to realize why they were here upon planet Earth. The Apostle Paul describes why God placed us here, Romans 12.
I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
God created us by his mercies, and we in return are to present ourselves back to God as a living sacrifice. God wants people to live for him, amen? Day by day, as you walk with him here on earth, some will be martyrs, but God mainly has called each of us to live for him day by day. Then the next verse says we're not to allow the world to squeeze us into their mold. The world has one kind of mold for your life. God has another. The mold that the world has is influenced by politics, by television, by radio, by society that we live in today, but always remember that God doesn't want us to be conformed to this world. We're only strangers and pilgrims down here, looking for a city which hath foundation, whose builder and maker is God. Give the Lord a big hand. Amen. Because of this, David said that he found his pleasure in God. Psalm 16:8.
I have set the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I shall not be moved. Therefore, my heart is glad, and my glory rejoices. My flesh also shall rest in hope.
Our life here on earth is to be lived like this. Do everything as if you are doing it for Jesus. That'll make all the difference in the world. It'll be easier to get up on Monday morning and go to work if you do it for Jesus. It'll be easier to put up with all the criticism you have if you're doing it for Jesus. But if we're selfish and look in our own life, life is going to become very, very difficult. Then as a church, we become a fellowship and we grow in Him by our fellowship together. Romans 12:5.
So we, being many, are one body in Christ, and everyone members one of another.
Okay, God has placed us in the church as families in His body, that we might grow in Him. Now, families have differences. The church has differences. Especially in the international church, we have a lot of differences. But we gather together with one thing in mind, the Lord Jesus Christ. Centering our worship, centering our mind upon Him. And when we do that, it makes all the difference in the world. Other believers become our brothers and our sisters. And we are to treat them like brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ. Whether they come from the jungles of South America, whether they come from Africa, whether they come from the islands of the sea, we greet them in the name of the Lord and say, "You're my brother. Let's shake hands." Amen. That's how God has placed us. The church is our spiritual family to help us to grow in God. And Paul tells Timothy again,
"These things I write unto thee, hoping to come unto thee shortly. But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth."
Okay, Paul says he's writing this so we might know how to behave in the church. Our fellowship is built upon honesty, humility, courtesy, hospitality, mutuality, and unity. We're to keep the unity of the faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And in Romans chapter 12, verse 9, he describes this.
"Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. Cleave to that which is good. Be kindly affectionate one to another with brotherly love, in honor preferring one another, not slothful in business, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, patience in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer, distributing to the necessity of saints, given to hospitality. Bless them which persecute you, bless and curse not. Rejoice with them that do rejoice, and weep with them that weep. Be of the same mind one toward another. Mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits."
Okay, here Paul is instructing the Roman church how they are supposed to behave in humility before God. In church, we desire a place where we're able to share our true feelings. Our differences are respected. We're encouraged to grow spiritually. We spend time with people getting to know them. And we are supported in our purpose and are accepted despite of our weaknesses. God knows our weaknesses, and He accepts us because it's not our weakness, it's God's strength, amen? And God's strength is in your life and in mine today. I heard one time of a little boy that was petting the cat backwards and just ruffling his fur all up. And the parents said, "Why are you doing that? The cat doesn't like that." And the little boy said, "Well, the cat could turn around." And sometimes we have to turn around, don't we? Because people are rubbing us the wrong direction. So remember, maybe God wants us to turn around. Amen. Then we also prepare ourselves for discipleship because Jesus said we're to go to all the world, preach the gospel, making disciples of all men. We are all created to become like Christ. We haven't become like Him, but eventually, someday when we stand before Him, we're going to see Him. And when we see Him, we're going to become like Him. Hallelujah. That's our goal. That's what God has told us in His Word. God's ultimate goal to our life is character building. In order to do that, God gave us the Bible that we can know how we're to behave and how we're to express ourselves. 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul tells Timothy what God's word is given to us for.
All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, and for instructions in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
Okay, and I like all these but two of them. I don't like for reproof, and I don't like for correction. Isn't that right? You remember what Dad and Mom told you and you tell to your children? I'm giving you the spanking because I love you. And you look up and say, well, you don't have to love me that much right now. So God does this for our reproof and our correction as we are serving Him. God uses circumstances to help us to become more like Him. Here is a scripture that we like to quote to other people. And when it comes to us, sometimes we hesitate because we don't understand. What's it say, Brother Dan?
And we know that all things work together for the good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to His purpose.
Okay, a couple of things it says. It's working together for good to them that love God and to those that are called according to God's purpose. God is going to do everything in your life to help you to become and fulfill the reason why you were born and why you're living on planet Earth today. We are put on Earth to make a contribution, not to take from the Earth, but rather to contribute to our livelihood. And Peter says this,
as every man hath received the gift, even so minister the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God.
Okay, and now I want to tell you some of the ways that God does that, and we're going to use what somebody has given us. It is called SHAPED, S-H-A-P-E-D. How do we become shaped in the image of God? The first is God gives us spiritual gifts. When we are born, God gives us spiritual gifts. Just like when we are born naturally, God gives us natural gifts that we can use. That's why when we see a tall man, we say, do you play basketball? When we say a short man, do you play miniature golf? I used to tell my wife that God made her short so she could pull the weeds out of the garden. She doesn't have that far to stoop over. But God makes us in different ways, gives us special abilities to do different things in different ways. So the first is spiritual gifts. The second is the H, which is for heart. What is our passion or our desires? The way we accomplish our dreams is this way. Delight thyself in the Lord, and He will give you what? The desires of your heart. Be happy. Delight yourself. Thank God for what you have, and God will give you more. Take care of the old car you have. Be thankful for it. Somewhere you'll get a new one along the way. Why? Because if we delight ourselves in it, the Bible says that God is going to give us the desires of our heart. So we have S-H-A is abilities. That is what we do well. Exodus 31:3.
And I have filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge and in all manner of workmanship.
Okay, this scripture is given to a working man. A working man, not a prophet. It's the first time in the Bible that it says that God filled somebody with His Spirit. Outside of breathing into man, the Spirit of life, but the gifts of the Spirit, God gave Aholibah and his buddy a special gift to work and design the things that he was going to make for the tabernacle out there in the wilderness. God can give you, by his Spirit, the ability to do things well. Amen? And if you struggle in this area, pray that God will give you his ability within your life in order to do what God has called you to do. Amen. Then the next is our personalities. Some are introverts, others are extroverts, some are in between. Some have self-control, some are self-expressive, some are cooperative, some are competitive. And so God places us where our personality will help us to do what God has called us to do. And the E stands for experiences. What have we done in the past? What have we done well? If we do what God has given us to do well, then probably we can go on those experiences and God will do something in the future. As you know, almost everywhere I've been, I've always been a builder, whether it's a camp, whether it's here, wherever it has been, I've built buildings. Built the building up on Sunset and Backlick. And then we moved down here. We built all these buildings here since I've been here. And first it's a small building, then it's a bigger building and a bigger one. And that's why we have this beautiful auditorium to worship God in. God leads us step by step. Now, if it had been the sanctuary I built first, my first building was a $3,000 shower building at camp. We had about two or three showers and trying to run 500 kids through them in a half hour. All we did was sprinkle them. But finally, I got that built. Then I built another building at camp and another building. Then we came here. We built the building up on Sunset and Backlick. Then we built a small chapel and the education building. Then we built the gymnasium with the prayer room over top of it. Then we built this building and then the children's building and adult building on the other side. Step by step, God leads us. Amen? First the bear, then the lion, and then the giant. That's how God leads us day by day. Then we are to reach our potential in evangelism. Brother Azim is reaching out to our area and getting many to help him reach out to the Muslim people of this area. And during that time, he also reaches other people. But we're to go outside our walls and reach people with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We do that by sharing our testimony. We turn our test into a testimony. And the way we do that is by sharing what life was like before we found Christ. How we experienced Jesus Christ in our life. And the difference and the change it has made is to inspire others to be disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. So day by day, God helps us to share the gospel with others. We bring pleasure to God through our worship. Experiencing life together through fellowship. Growing spiritually to become more like Christ through discipleship. Serving the need of others through ministry. And sharing the good news through evangelism is the way we reach our potential in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's bow our heads in prayer. While our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed and everybody's praying together, maybe today you've come to church and you don't really know Jesus. The greatest thing in the world is to know Christ as your Savior. Life is empty without Him. Life here on earth is too short to live it without Jesus, because eternity is long. When we come to the Lord Jesus Christ, we open our heart and invite Him to come into our life. We're going to do that in just a few moments. Right where you're sitting, right where you are before the Lord, just between you and God. The Bible says if we believe that Jesus came, believe that He lived and He died, believe that He was buried in a grave, but He arose from the dead and ascended back into the Father, and He's coming again. Believe that in your heart. Confess it with your mouth. You will be saved. We're going to do that at this time. I'm going to ask everybody to join your faith together with others who may be praying this prayer for the very first time. Dear Jesus, everybody pray, dear Jesus, I come to you today. I thank you that you came into this world and you died upon the cross. You were buried in a grave, but you arose from the dead, and today you are alive. I believe in you, Jesus. Forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. I make you Lord of my life. I thank you for saving me in Jesus' name. Now will you look up and thank Him? Lord, we thank you today that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God.
Of honor.
Hallelujah.
A vessel of honor for God, sanctified, holy, so I might be a vessel of honor.
Sing it, Brother Bill.
A vessel of honor.
Sing it with him.
For God.
Lord, help us to have vessels of honor unto you, we pray.
A vessel of honor for God. Sanctified, holy, so I. A vessel of honor
to you. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because He first loved me, and to me He is so wonderful. To me, He is so wonderful. To me, He is so wonderful. To know that Jesus is mine. And it's oh, how I sing it to Him today. Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Let's stand together as we sing it again. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus,
because he first
loved me. I'm going to ask the ladies that have the shawls that they've made to come and stand before the front. We're going to anoint them. These are taken out to needy people, to those that are sick, to those that are shut in. God will be with them and bless them. They do a beautiful job with these. Yeah, take them out so we can see some of them. This is beautiful. This is a lot of work, many, many hours that they put in. God bless you. Brother Waldy and Brother Dan's going to anoint them, and we're going to pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the work of our ladies' hands. Lord, these shawls are going to touch the lives of needy people. And I pray, Lord, that when they touch them, they will realize that it's a special blessing from God, that the anointing of the Holy Spirit will give them new life, new strength, and new hope, because our faith is in you. We thank you, Lord, and as they continue doing this, that many individuals will be blessed by the power of your Spirit. Granted, and we'll thank you in your wonderful name. And everybody said, give the ladies a big hand for doing this. Amen. I'm going to ask Brother Paul Lawrence and his family to come and stand. I understand you've lost a loved one. Is that right? So if you'll come here to the front in the middle, we ask some of the deacons and others to come and gather around you. Amen. Stretch your hand towards the Lawrence family today. Lord Jesus, we know that you know the sorrow that's come to this family. Lord Jesus, words cannot help it, but you can. Comfort them, Lord, with the comfort and the strength that only you can give.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, that when we know you, we have hope for eternity.
Yes.
And I pray, Lord, that you would be with this family in a very, very special way. We believe you and thank you, Lord, that you're going to do this by the power of the Holy Spirit. And Lord, likewise, we pray for Institute's family today and the loss of their son, that you would be with them in a very special way. Let each of them know that you're here today to comfort, to strength. And Lord, as they build their life without the loved one, I pray that you would go before and prepare the way.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for all that you're going to do to bring glory and honor to your wonderful name. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Lay your hand on the shoulder, the one on the right and the one on the left. We're going to pray for everybody at this time. Then Brother Isaac's going to come and pray the closing prayer. He's going to pray for our president, pray for our military. Pray for leaders around the world and pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Pray one for another. Lord Jesus, we pray for our brothers and sisters that are here today. And Lord, our brothers and sisters around the world, that you would be with them in a very special way. Thank you, Lord, for the gifts that you give your people. And together we share what you blessed our life with. Thank you, Lord, that when we share our joys, they increase. We share our sorrows, they diminish. Thank you, Lord, for the strength that we feel of family, and especially the church family. Be with each one, I pray. Bring healing to relationships. Yes, Lord. Healing to bodies. Yes, Lord. Healing to families, we pray. God, touched by your mighty power. Yes. As this is Miracle Sunday, we pray that you would work the miracle that each individual needs in their own personal life and in their families. We believe you and thank you for what you're going to do. Your wonderful name, amen. Give the Lord another big hand. Now we're going to receive God's blessing, and after that, Brother Isaac will pray the closing prayer. Remember, there's church tonight. Matter of fact, tonight is a night of worship. Brother Bill will be leading us, so make sure you're here to worship the Lord. Lord, bless me.
Bless me.
Enlarge my territory.
Enlarge my territory.
Let your hand be upon me.
Let your hand be upon me.
Keep me from the evil one.
Keep me from the evil one.
And the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you God's peace.
Hallelujah.
Father, we believe that this is a peace that comes down from above. No one else can give it to us, but Lord, you are here today imparting peace and comfort to the lives of your people. This we ask in your wonderful name. And everybody said, amen. Amen. Give Jesus another big hand. Brother Isaac.
Father, we thank you for the message that has been released in our midst today, God, reminding us that you are for us to reach our destiny. You are for us to reach our purpose. And Lord, we pray that even every areas of our life, especially our relationship with you, God, that it will reach that purpose of intimacy that we have with you. Even in our worship, in our service, in our evangelism, Father, we thank you because we have the Holy Spirit that is in us, who will empower us to do the things that you desire for us to do. Father, at this time, we join our hearts praying for our government, praying for our president, praying for the forthcoming election. Father, what's going on around the world, it seems to be there are many reasons for us to be fearful. But Father, you said, fear not, for I am with you. Fear not, for I am with you. Father, we thank you because you will never leave us nor forsake us. Father, in whatever journey that we have, we know that you will be with us, that your hands of protection will be upon us to reach our destiny, to reach the purpose that we have for you. Father, we pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Lord, I release the peace, not only the physical peace that they need right now, but also the peace that passes all understanding that only can be given by our relationship with Jesus. Lord, I pray that many Jewish brothers and sisters will come to the saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, we thank you because you said, pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and those who bless Jerusalem, bless those who bless Israel will be blessed as well. Father, may we be the church, may we be the believers that bless your chosen nation. Lord, even as we step out from this place, we will continue to be in your presence. And we thank you for that, Lord, that you will never leave us. You will continue to be with us, God. And Father, we give you praise. We give you honor. Can we do that? Even as we step out of this place, can we give the best praise and thanksgiving to God because he deserves it? He deserves it. Father, we give you praise. We honor you, God. All the praise and honor belongs to you, O God. May our lives manifest the greatness of your grace and your mercy towards us. And we will continue to give you the praise and the glory. Bless your people, I pray. In the name of Jesus, the wonderful and powerful name of Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Hallelujah.
To my soul